It's a showdown of constitutional proportion as Democrats in Washington square off against Donald Trump over the Mueller report, congressional subpoenas, and the power of Congress to check the executive branch. The only thing the two sides seem to agree on, the stakes are high.
We've talked for a long time about approaching a constitutional crisis. We are now in it. We are now in a constitutional crisis.
I will not, though, become a bystander as we assail the Attorney General and this committee. Our democracy deserves better.
Tensions have been brewing since Attorney General Bill Barr skipped out on a scheduled hearing with the House Judiciary Committee last week and then refused to comply with a subpoena for redacted portions of the Mueller report and its underlying evidence. Since then, the president declared executive privilege over the entire report. Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin refused to release Trump's tax returns to Congress. And House Democrats started the process of holding the Attorney General in contempt, none of which seems to faze Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell.
The Mueller report has been filed. The case is closed. We have their report. My view is it's time to move on.
Though apparently some in his own caucus did not get the message, because the Republican chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee issued a subpoena yesterday to compel the president's son, Don Jr., to testify, something even special counsel Bob Mueller didn't do in his investigation. And if he refuses?
If Donald Trump Jr. defies this subpoena, he ought to be jailed. Well, he may be the president's son, but he's not above the law and he has no privilege whatsoever.
Joining me now to discuss are Charlie Chieppo, Charlie's senior fellow at the Pioneer Institute and former policy director for Governor Romney. Good to see you, Charlie. Gautam Mukunda is a Harvard Kennedy School fellow and author of Indispensable, When Leaders Really Matter. Good to see you, too. Charlie, Nancy Pelosi says Trump's trying to goad the House Democrats into impeaching him. She came up with the term that he is essentially self-impeaching, whatever that means. Is he, and would it impeachment hurt the Democrats as in 2020 as much as Pelosi seems to fear?
Well, I'm not sure what self-impeaching is, but certainly I assume she means that he tends to step on his own, you know, on his own foot, which he's certainly doing. But I do think that in current circumstances, unless something else really horrible happens, which certainly could, that yeah, it is probably not a good political move to try to go after him for impeachment on the, you know, unless there is more evidence than there is right now.
But can they avoid? I mean, when he continues to stonewall on everything, there's no room for compromise, no movement towards the middle. They look like fools, don't they, to just take it and go to court?
There's a point of bad action by Trump, which we're rapidly approaching, I think, where the matter of impeachment becomes not a political question, but one of constitutional duty. All of these people swore an oath to uphold the Constitution. The Republicans don't seem to be remembering that fact, but the Democrats seem to. And past a certain point, you just have to, it's not about the politics anymore. It's about the fact that we live in one of the world's oldest constitutional republics, and it has to be maintained somewhere.
And do you buy the notion that, I mean, talk about perverse, that the President of the United States is goading the House Democrats to impeach him?
So that's a sort of attributing grand strategy to Trump, not a guy who's demonstrated a lot of ability for that, right? Like, this is what he does. He wages wars. His entire career has been characterized by constant frivolous litigation meant to wear down his opponents and play out the clock. What he's doing is he's taking this to the courts in the hope, I think, that he can make sure that what they're looking for won't come out before the 2020 elections.
That's, you know, the partisan nature of this, which is obviously what Nancy Pelosi is concerned about, is played out, you know, when you have Mitch McConnell saying case closed, Republicans are closing ranks. But then Richard Burr, the chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee, a Republican, obviously, subpoenas Don Jr. Does that not change the dynamic? I know it's only one Republican, but it's a really powerful Republican and allows the Democrats to say it's not just us. The Senate Republican Intelligence Chair wants to talk to Don Jr. Does that help change the political dynamic?
Well, yes, but I think also for another reason, because I think what it does is it opens the door, perhaps, or makes it a little bit easier for some other Republicans to step up as well. They certainly have not seemed willing to do that up until now.
Well, look, when your former boss, Mitt Romney, now Senator Romney, criticized said how troubled he was by the Mueller report. Virtually nobody joined him in that. I mean, it was a one and done, which is often what it is. Do you agree that Burr helps the Democrats here?
He does, but I don't think the political importance of this is very high. This is the sort of a weird case where American public cynicism about politics actually exceeds the reality.
What does that mean?
So I think the response to from the mass public as a whole is, oh, the Russians were helping him. He was happy about it. Everybody would respond that way. Now, actually, everybody would not respond that way. There are, in fact, multiple examples during the Cold War of the Soviets offering assistance to candidates who turned them down and reported them to the FBI. That happened. right? So in fact, most candidates, I mean, I'm not saying politicians are great people. I'm saying that this level of cynicism, other than Donald Trump, the rest of the American political system has not yet reached. And people are underestimating their politicians.
Speaking of changing dynamic, if this guy showed up to testify before the House, this is him testifying as the FBI director in 2013, if Bob Mueller shows up, does that not change the dynamic, at least some?
I mean, we don't know what he'll say, right? And it'll certainly be gripping television. The more this is in the news, the more it hurts Trump. People keep talking about Trump's invulnerability to bad news. He is running a booming economy, a 4% unemployment rate, and we are, in relative terms, at peace. And he's at 41.5%
Well, actually, he's not. He's maybe one poll, but we can put it up here. Gallup has him at the highest number he's had in his presidency, 46%, up from 37 in just January. And as the Drudge Report makes quite clear, he has a higher number, according to Gallup, than Barack Obama did at the same point in his presidency. That's not nothing. It's not 50% for an incumbent, but it's not nothing.
It's not nothing, but if you look at the polling average, right? Polls fluctuate. If you look at the polling average, Trump is at 41.5, which is exactly where he's been for pretty much the entire presidency.
And if you also look at the polling compared to how the economy is doing.
Yeah, that's the exact point I was making.
You know, that it's not such a great number when you consider that it's arguably the best economy in 50 years.
But that number is building, and the assumption is if you watch trending in polling, which all three of us do, it tends to trend in a direction. And if the economy continues to improve, assuming that this Chinese tariff thing does not throw everything off kilter, one would assume that his numbers continue to build, too. I mean, the conventional wisdom was his ceiling was 40%. That's what a lot of the experts said, but it obviously is not.
But one would also assume that in November of next year, the economy is unlikely to be as good as it is right now.
You know, speaking of economy, at least economics, the New York Times did another incredible piece of reporting, which I assume you guys read, looked at 10 years of Donald Trump's, tax transcripts, whatever they are, reflecting his returns from the mid-'80s to the mid-'90s, and showed him, I hope people don't think I was using rhetorical excess when it showed him to be one of the biggest financial losers in that decade. They're able to show, without identifiers, that I think there were only three taxpayers in America who lost more money in 1985 than he did, totally undercutting the self-created myth.
In the midst of a boom.
Exactly. Yeah. That's a wonderful point. Yeah. The self-created myth that I can run this country because I know the system better than anybody else. I am the best business, the art of the deal. That doesn't bother anybody either, does it?
Let's be clear. In 1985, if you hired a monkey to throw darts at a map of Manhattan and bought whatever the darts landed on, you would have made a profit, right?
Like, that's right?
That's what it took to do what he did. So I want to say something that possibly no one has ever said in the history of this show.
Okay.
I was wrong about Donald Trump. Ooh. I was completely wrong about Donald Trump. I assumed that of all 300 million Americans, there was one who was worse at business than Donald Trump. And I was completely wrong.
This man's from the Harvard Business School, I should say. But does that mean, you know, getting back to the I could shoot someone on Fifth Avenue, you say, you read this thing, it is really powerful, really well reported, undercuts so much of the reputation of the man, it doesn't move the needle at all, does it?
Probably not. But let's see. You know, we'll see over time. It's hard to say, a day after he addressed it.
When people do focus groups on Trump supporters, there are two things that we can support for him. One is when you really undercut his business strength and show that, hey, no, it was just The Apprentice. He actually belonged on The Biggest Loser.
So this may. What's the other one?
Over time. The other is when you tell them how many people from Goldman are in his cabinet. So Elizabeth Warren, I imagine, is paying attention to those two things and saying, I bet I might be able to do something with
that. May have hurt Hillary Clinton, too, those speeches for $250,000. Is there a vulnerability that you see along the lines of that? We only have 30 seconds left in Trump that's not being exploited by the Democrats?
I mean, there could be, but I think all that stuff is easier to exploit when the economy slows down. I just think that that's sort of a threshold issue.
Gentlemen, thank you. We've got to go. Gautam, it's great to see you. Charlie, thank you for your time. As always, appreciate it, gentlemen.